We probably should get started since we will finish a little bit earlier so that people can go attend the talk by Arcano. What I want to do today is bring together a little bit the two topics that we had in the last time, last two lectures, which were very much geared to discrete optimization. We will return to that a little bit in the second part of this lecture. In the first part, I just want to sketch one facet of algebraic graph theory that is probably of interest and also has a direct applications in the life sciences, in particular for the characterization of molecular structures. Our topic today will be cyclic bases of graphs. So as usual, we will only look at finite graphs. So we have a graph G with a finite vertex set and corresponding here finite edge set. And for today, we will basically not really be interested in isolated vertices. So we will focus essentially on the edges in the graph. So intuitively, what is a cycle in a graph? If we have a graph, say, that looks like this, well, a cycle is what you probably would think of as a cycle. It's a closed path. So a cycle is the same thing as a closed path. We will interpret cycles and paths just as sets of edges. That simplifies life a lot if we don't really have to care about any leftover isolated vertices somewhere. Since paths do not use nodes and therefore also no edges more than once, we can obviously characterize paths just by giving the list or the set of their edges in an arbitrary order. So there is a one-to-one correspondence between path in a graph and just edge sets that have certain properties, such as not having branches, essentially. So we consider all of these things basically as subsets of the edge set E. In that context, it also makes sense to talk about something that's usually called generalized cycles, which is simply an edge disjoint union of cycles. Why would anybody care about looking at generalized cycles? Well, the idea basically is if we have the edge set of a, if we have a cycle C1 and we have another cycle C2 and we just compute the symmetric difference which for obscure reasons in this field happens to be always denoted by this circle plus, which has nothing to do with a direct sum or something like this. So this it's just a customary notation in essentially all the literature on this topic. Then if we add up the edge set of this cycle, by calculating the symmetric difference, what we get is again is a disjoint union of the cycles if they had no edges in between, in common between them, or if these cycles had, say, an edge in common, all that happens is that we erase this edge, and we wind up again with a cycle. So to look at that a little bit more rationally, a cycle is a closed path. We can also say, well, this is a subgraph such that every vertex has even degree, has degree 2, sorry. And it is connected. So that should be rather obvious that what we normally think of a cycle, so a closed path, is just a subgraph in our graph where every vertex along this graph has degree 2. Right, so from every vertex that we go out one direction, and since the path is closed, we come back at another edge. So every every vertex has exactly 2 incident edges, and since this thing is along a path, it is connected. So the generalized cycles are exactly the subgraphs with all vertex degrees, even, right? So if I take 2 of these, if I just take a disjoint union, this is trivial, that if every vertex degree is 2, then if you just take a disjoint union of these things, everything still has vertex degree 2, we just gave up on connectedness. Since we only want edge disjoint unions, we can have a vertex where we have several cycles go through that, right? And every cycle that runs through this common vertex just adds 2 edges, because all the cycles pairwisely do not share edges. So every vertex obviously gets an even degree. So we can just characterize these generalized cycles as the subgraphs of our given graph that have only even degree vertices. There is a name for these graphs. Those are the Eulerian subgraphs. Those are actually the ones where you can run through all edges of the graph without repetition in kind of one cycle. Right, so those are the all the newspaper quiz examples where draw something without lifting the pencil from one node to the next along a given set of edges. Those are exactly the those subgraphs. So this is actually the oldest result in graph theory that goes back to Leonhard Euler with his famous Königsberg bridge problem in 1750-something, I think. So if you think about this symmetric difference of these graphs, okay, so if we sit at vertices where we only add up disjoint edges, then adding even numbers gives even numbers again. And if we look at edges that we erase. So if we have the same edge twice, we just get rid of it. We also retain at the end an even number of edges at all the vertices where we erase adjacent edges. So this symmetric difference operation retains the property that the subgraphs have only even degree. So in other words, the symmetric difference operation remains closed on the set of generalized cycles. And this is the reason why you want to look at generalized cycles, basically because we can happily perform this addition operation. We can also think of the sets of edges in each one of these cycles as a vector indexed by the edges. What we have there, and my kind of obvious symmetric difference is a group operation, right? I don't have to go through explaining that. It's always self-inverse. So if you add a cycle to itself, all the edges disappear. Right? The symmetric difference is empty. So we also have to allow us, as the neutral element of this addition operation, to have an empty graph which just has no edges in it. So then, within every graph, we have this nice group operation on the sets of edges. These edges really are vectors that we can play around with. The underlying field, obviously, is the field of just 0 and 1, where the addition is symmetric, is XOR, right? So we have 1 plus 1 is 0, and the multiplication is the usual multiplication on the field of two numbers. So this is basically, so we can think of the cycles as a vector space over F2. This construction immediately begs the question, what do the bases look like of this vector space, right? So first of all, can we say anything about the dimension of this vector space of cycles? And if so, given a graph, is there cheap ways of constructing basis of this vector space? It turns out, without proof, because that's a little bit technical, and I want to get to more interesting things, the dimension of this thing, which is called the cyclic space, which is just the set of subgraphs with even degree and this operation, we have this XO operation on the cycle sets, on the edge sets. So if we look at the dimension of this vector space, then it turns out this the dimension of this vector space is the number of edges minus the number of vertices plus the number of connected components. Another rather obvious insight into this structure is that because it's defined as the disjoint union of cycles, we should be able to produce a basis of this thing that's made up of only of cycles, because obviously everything else we can get as a disjoint union of these of the cycles. So of the elementary cycles, if we want to emphasize that they really have this degree two, just one path around it. So in terms of constructing bases, we're essentially only interested in bases that we can construct out of cycles, right? We don't want any complicated constructions consisting of multiple elementary cycles. And one of the classical results, this is actually also in this case 19th century mathematics, and it underlies essentially the theory of electrical networks from by Kirchhoff, is the following construction, which is named after him. So there is a set of basis construction called the Kirchhoff basis, and they work like this. So let T be a spanning tree in G. So we already had spanning trees ad nauseum. Just to remind you, a spanning tree is a tree that is a subgraph of G and contains every vertex. And then we consider an edge in E minus T, so an edge that's not an edge in the spanning tree. Again, I'm kind of a little bit sloppy in my notation, because also the spanning tree is defined just by its set of edges. So whenever we can, we just drop any reference to the vertices. We basically just needed the vertices to define this construction here. If we take an edge that's not part of a spanning tree, then there is a unique cycle which we call cycle of E and T in T plus this extra edge. Right? I mean, that's obvious. We have a tree. We take two leaves of the tree, or two nodes in the tree that are connected by an extra edge E in the graph. So these two endpoints of this extra edge, they are obviously connected by the edge, and they are also, because we have a spanning tree, connected by a path in T, actually unique path in T. We just given a spanning tree and a non-spanning tree edge, this defines a unique cycle. what we then get, the set of these cycles is a basis of the cycle space. I call it K because it's the Kirchhoff basis. Why is this right? First question, why are these cycles all linearly independent? If they are a basis, so linear independent with respect to this operation here. Well, quite obviously, every one of these cycles contains an edge that is not contained in any other cycle. So whatever you do in terms of adding up these cycles, you will never be able to generate this particular edge as the sum of some of the other cycles, because none of the other cycles contains that edge. And so the whole point of that basis is you have an edge, kind of a coordinate, that is private to that one cycle So you need it in your basis. The dimension of that thing is very easy to get. So what's the number of elements of this K, where this is the number of edges minus the number of edges that are in a spanning tree. And if you have a tree on a graph with V nodes, so for the moment, assuming that the graph is connected, we get this T is just the number of vertices minus one in a connected graph. So this thing is just E minus V plus one, which is right for a connected graph. So obviously we cannot have a spanning tree in a graph that is not connected, but we can have a spanning tree in every connected component. So we get something like this in every connected component, which basically means that if we have more than one connected component, we just have to replace this one by the number of connected components. So we get the number of independent cycles that we actually need to have. The proof that, so just as a side remark, the proof that this is really the right number of cycles goes by looking at the orthogonal space, which one can show that this is the space that's generated by the cuts, and those in turn, the cuts you can generate again, taking the same spanning tree, and you just cut one edge in that spanning tree that divides the set of vertices into two parts, and then your cut consists of all the edges that connect the two parts, and it's not hard to show that this thing is orthogonal to any cycle. So therefore, everything that's a cut is not a cycle, and we are done. So this is one connection or one a construction that's of interest here. Another construction is kind of also funny because. It also goes back to a very old result on graphs. This is called the Ihr decomposition. And from here on, we will actually not only consider connected graphs, but it actually makes sense to look at so-called two connected graphs only. There is a lot of alternative definitions of what it means to be a two connected graph. The one that's most relevant for us is a graph is two connected if every two vertices are contained in a common cycle. So in particular, something that looks like this is still connected, but vertices in here and vertices over there are not contained in a common cycle. Since we are only interested in bases of the cyclic space that are cyclic and not just some generalized things, it's kind of obvious that in this case you can find a basis of the cyclic space over here and the basis of the cyclic space in the other component, the other two connected component, and the cyclic space will just be the direct sum of these things. So. It's not interesting. Basically, these cases are also not interesting, and it is sufficient to look at the cyclic spaces of the two connected components for anything interesting that you can say. So it actually makes sense to restrict ourselves to just the two connected components of the cycle space. The year decomposition relies on a deceptively simple observation about two connected graphs, and this is the existence of so-called open ears. An open ear in a two connected graph is a path whose inner vertices, if any, so we also allow the path to just be an edge, whose inner vertices all have degree 2. And its endpoints are distinct. So in particular, an edge is also an ear. So the idea basically is we have this graph here somewhere, and then you have two endpoints, x and y, and then we have a path connecting these two endpoints so that every point along this path is not connected to anything else in that graph. So it's really something that kind of hangs off. And the year decomposition depends on the following result from Whitney that one can state like this, if G is two connected, then there is an ear . So then we have an ear. Let's call this P because it's a path such that G without that path, where I just mean ripping out all the edges and all the, so G without P is obtained by removing the edges of the path and getting rid of all the isolated vertices that are left over, but it retains the attachment vertices, okay? So this retains the endpoints. Is again two connected. Yeah.
You're saying that an open ear is a path, yeah, whereas all the vertices have degree 2, but by definition, all paths have inner degrees 2.
Yeah. So what I mean by that is the degree measured in the whole graph G, not in the subgraph that I take out. So, I'm not thinking of the ear as a subgraph that I kind of take out of the graph.
Okay, but
we're
not saying it's a subgraph who's in a or a new subgraph.
No, it's also not. So you're not, what you cannot have is that there is an extra edge to anything else in the graph. So if you just take this thing as an induced subgraph, you would still allow that this edge here exists, right?
Yeah, okay.
Because if I only look at the subgraph in isolation, then if I take the path out, obviously everything in, inside has degree two. But what I want is I want to measure the degree here explicitly. I want to measure that degree in G in the original graph, not in the in the subgraph that I take out.
Okay, but then this mod,
this dotted line must not exist. This is exactly the point.
We can also, so we can basically say open here is induced subgraph, who is all in a vertex except two.
Do I care about? Yeah.
And that's
okay.
In particular, so if subgraph is a path, when we
right.
Okay.
No. So take this example here. Let's put something here, right? Then if we take this thing here, as an induced subgraph, this is a path, right? But I'm not allowed to take this because I have this, this extra edge here. So you cannot characterize what I mean by an ear by just looking at what the subgraph looks like or the induced subgraph looks like. You explicitly have to say that all the inner vertices of this path had no other edge in the original graph incident with them.
Mm.
Okay? That's not the same thing as saying I look at an induced subgraph. And we this is really needed here, because the point is you identify these ears; they are not attached to anything else, and you can rip them out. So, because what this gives you, so if there if every two connected graph has an ear, so that if I rip that ear out, I again get the two connected graph. That means I get a stepwise decomposition. Of this graph until I wind up necessarily with a single cycle. So strictly speaking, as formulated here, and this is only true for every two connected graph that is not just a cycle. But the kind of convention that one makes is to say that if I have a if my graph is a cycle, then I just consider this cycle as being a single ear. So this is basically just so that we don't have to make exceptions all the time, right? The proof for that is not quite trivial, but the idea on how you on why this is true is actually relatively simple. So if your graph does not have a cut consisting of only two edges, then you can just take whatever cut and rip out one of the edge and possibly anything that's in the corresponding year, right? So if I take a, if I have a path like this and I identify one of these edges as a cut in there, then obviously I can identify what the remaining path is and get rid of this. So the difficult case is when you wind up with something like this, right? So your graph has a your graph has a cut consisting of exactly two edges. So then, what's left here are either two connected components. Then I just continue in one in these two connected components and leave these edges alone, or it actually looks like this, and there is no, this part here is not too connected anymore. If this part is not too connected anymore, then all that is left Since I know the whole graph is too connected, all that is left is actually an ear, and I can just get rid of this ear. So modulo technicalities, this is basically the reason why this is true. So every two connected graph has an open ear decomposition that allows it to rip out one ear. Stepwisely, now you might ask, what does that have to do with the cyclic basis, where we can use this ear decomposition immediately to construct a cyclic basis. And the idea is essentially we take an ear, plus, since the remaining graph is two connected, here, just some connecting path between the endpoints that gives us a cycle. This cycle contains the edges of the ear, which are not contained in any cycle that's in the remainder of the graph. So obviously that thing is linearly independent from whatever the cyclic basis is in the smaller graph. And then just iterate. So the the idea is basically the outermost ear that I remove contains edges that is that are not part of anything in the remainder of the graph. So whatever the cyclic basis is of the remainder of the graph, it has to be linearly independent from the last ear. And then you just go down the telescope and repeat the argument for the graph that's one smaller, so you get that the cycles that you get from the individual ears are always always linearly independent from everything that's further inside. So linear independence is not difficult. The other problem is, do we get the right number of cycles? Well, by the rule of what happens when we remove the ear, we remove, let's say, p edges and p minus one vertices. And we remove one cycle. Or we put one cycle into the cyclic basis, if you want. So the dimension of the cyclic space of the remaining graph is one smaller, which is exactly what we're doing if we remove one edge more, since we had the number of edges minus the number of vertices plus one. So now what we do is, we remove p edges, p minus one, and p minus one vertices. So the dimension of that thing really reduces by one if we just take the one cycle out. Right? So nicely, this does exactly what we want. Gives us a linearly independent set of cycles of the right size. For practical applications, usually we don't just want any cyclic basis, we actually want cyclic basis that are small. And that immediately connects back to the first lecture we had. What would we want to do to get the cyclic basis that is in a sense as small as possible, or more precisely consists of cycles that are as short as possible. The natural way to say I want a basis that's in a sense as small as possible would basically be to say what we want is we want a length or a size function for a basis, so let B be a basis and just say L of B is just the sum over all the cycles in our basis. And because we are lazy and don't want to define weight functions and whatever, now we just take as the weight the length of the cycle. You can also do the very same thing in the same way as we did two lectures back for the greedy algorithm. We can also just attach an arbitrary weight function to the edges and say the weight of a cycle is the sum of the lengths of the edges in the cycle, so and this, the lengths of the cyclic basis is just the sum of the weights of the cycle. So let's just use this cardinality sign as a sloppy way of also basically, because it's the customary way of writing it, as whatever the weight of that cycle is. So now basically we know essentially everything that we need to do in order to get a cyclic basis of the minimum length, at least in principle. The generalized cycles form a vector space, which is finite because everything is finite in these graphs. So in particular, the set of cycles is a matroid. So all we need to do is list all our cycles and run the greedy algorithm on them. This works in principle. And is actually a nice proof device because this basically tells us a lot of what the structure of minimal cyclic basis can be, as we will see in a moment. It is a singularly stupid way of trying to do it in practice. Why? How many cycles do we have in a graph? So, in general, can we give an upper bound at least? Well, we have a cycle, we have a basis of the cyclic space that is this E minus V plus 1, right? So we can, and we are working over F2. So we basically, if we want to construct a cycle, we put the basis element in, or we don't. Right? Doing it twice just removes it again. So an upper bound on the number of cycles is just 2 to the E minus V plus 1, which is like an awful lot. So it's basically 2 to the n squared if we have n vertices. But of course, this is not the proper cycles. This is the generalized cycles. So maybe the number of, maybe graphs are actually nice objects and the number of cycles is always small, maybe even polynomial. Then we would be very happy, because if the number of cycles is small, we would basically get the polynomial time algorithm for getting minimum length cyclic basis for free. Unfortunately, the number of cycles, even in very simple graphs, can grow exponentially. And kind of the standard example is this diamond necklace graph for this. How many cycles does this thing have? So this just means we can make this as large as we want, right? So we have here like 1, 2, 3, 4, and then here we have something like 4k plus 1, 4k plus 2, 4k plus 4, 4k plus 3, or something like this. So So if we have K of these diamonds, in total, how many cycles do we get here? Well, we get K cycles for these quadrangles. And then we get a cycle going around, but at every one of these diamonds, we can choose whether we go inside or we can go outside. So we get K plus 2 to the K cycles in this thing, and since this K is the number of vertices by 4 in this class of graphs, you immediately see that you can get an exponential number of cycles, and this can get a lot worse if you take denser graphs. So it's relatively easy to construct examples of graphs where it actually goes exponentially in the number of the edges. Which means bad idea to try to do that in practice. So what do we do instead? So a nice try would basically be to say, okay, let's try to use these basis constructions and maybe there is a way of actually optimize over these. This doesn't work, unfortunately. It's relatively simple to construct examples where the minimum cycle basis cannot be constructed from a spanning tree. Again, the classic example is this. So if we take this guy, then what we want is there's a unique minimum cyclic basis, right? Everybody sees that. That's just the planar one that I laid out. It consists of the three triangles and the one quadrangle. All other cycles have lengths 5 or what is it on the outside, 8 or 6 or whatever. So all the other cycles are longer. This thing actually has cycles of length 5, length 6, length 7, length 8. Lots of them, in fact. But it's actually very simple to see that this is a cycle basis. You can just count the number of vertices and edges to see that the quadrangle, that we should have 5 cycles in the cycle basis. Obviously, these three triangles, and so now we are burning up, or what is this? Okay, let's just ignore it until it smokes somewhere. If you look at this example, then it's also relatively easy to see that you cannot build a spanning tree in there that will give you all the 4 triangles. Right? Because whatever you do, you will always miss one of these edges here, and you can try to do all sorts of weird things of bypassing this. But at the end of the day, so if you try to bypass these ones here somewhere, then you still get another edge that you can't get here. So no matter what you do, Every cyclic basis that comes from a spanning tree has to contain at least a pentagon. So there's no way you can construct a minimum cyclic basis from spanning trees. And it's a bit more difficult to construct counterexamples, but it's also possible. You can also show that there is graphs that have minimal cyclic basis that are shorter than anything that you can get from a near decomposition. So neither types of cyclic basis constructions will actually give you minimum length basis, and one can actually show that the problem of finding a cyclic basis of minimum lengths that derives from a spanning tree or from a near decomposition are hard combinatorial optimization problems. While I claim this is not the case for the minimum cyclic basis problem in general. So it is actually possible to get to the minimum cyclic basis with polynomial time effort. So if we cannot do it constructively, the kind of obvious idea would be to say, can we reduce the set of cycles that we actually have to run our greedy algorithm over? Can we reduce that to something that's only of polynomial size? And in order to do that, we have to get the characterization of cycles that can possibly be part of a minimum cyclic basis. And as good mathematicians, we start with a definition. A cycle is relevant if it is contained in some minimal cyclic basis. So, and I claim that there is a very simple characterization of these cycles. I mean, this is not workable. This is a nice definition of what we want to look at. But we can get the following little lemma. A cycle is relevant if and only if it cannot be written as a sum of strictly shorter cycles. So why is this correct? So first, suppose our cycle can be written as the sum of all shorter cycles, and now we basically just use the greedy algorithm applied to all the to the set of all cycles as a proof device, right? So what does greedy do if we have a matroid, so we can just use the simple version of the greedy algorithm from the first lecture, which is to order the cycles by length. And what greedy will do is it will pick out cycles that are linearly independent. So if I can write my cycle of interest as a sum of shorter cycles, then either these cycles will be in the basis, or they will actually be linear combination of something that's even shorter, something that we depicted before. So strictly speaking, something that is no longer. So if I run my greedy algorithm on the set of all cycles, it will always reject a cycle that is written as this, that can be written as the sum of shorter cycles. So this can never be part of a minimum cycle basis. That's easy, right? So suppose I cannot write C as the sum of shorter cycles. Then I can use a sorting to feed into my greedy algorithm that has the cycle of interest as the first cycle of its length. So greedy will happily proceed through my sorted list of cycles, produce a basis of everything that is shorter than my a partial basis, so a linearly independent set of everything that is shorter than my cycle of interest. And now I get, as the first cycle of its length class, I get to the cycle that I'm interested in. By construction, this thing cannot be written as a sum of shorter cycles. So I cannot write it as something that I already, as a sum of something that I already have it in my basis. So it must be linearly independent of what I already have, and therefore it will be added to the growing basis. So it shows up in at least one minimum cycle basis. So this gives me a very nice characterization of the cycles that I'm actually interested in. And now essentially what I have to do is find a small enough set of cycles that contains the relevant cycles. And so the problem is, if I look at this example here, there still can be a lot of these cycles, right? Because if every one of these edges has length one, then all these cycles have the same lengths, right? All the ones that go around. So I actually can have an exponential number of relevant cycles. What one can do now is one can basically use a dirty trick and say, okay, there's kind of lots of equivalent, in a sense, cycles, right? Everything that I can get from where I can go from one cycle to another one by just adding shorter cycles to it. So if I want to go from the inside here to the outside, I just add this diamond to it, and I get from one of them to the other. What I can do to kind of break this symmetry, quote unquote, is to say, okay, so instead of using unit length, let's perturb these lengths a little bit. And we just add some very small irrational number so that none of them are rational multiples of each other. So let's just take whatever this, the square roots of primes or something like this and multiply that with something that's very, very small. So like 1 over the number of edges squared times the square root of the primes. We just add to each one of the edges. So the idea is I make little perturbations to the edge length that are so small that no sum of the edges, so that every that the sum of the if I just take the integer part of the sum of the lengths of every cycle, I just get back to the original lengths. but no two cycles then will have exactly the same length. Right? So it's pretty easy to come up with a perturbation, even in practice, that does that. So that means among all the cycles that have the same length, I've just given them some order. And it also means that in my graph now, shortest path between any two points are unique. And since this procedure doesn't, by making the perturbation small enough it doesn't break the ordering of the lengths of cycles that are different in the original ordering, right? So it's like I have lots of cycles of length 17. Now I have kind of a little band of cycles that have a length between 17 and 17.01, but the lengths are all different. So still, I can pick out of that anything in the lowest length band, so to speak, is still a minimum cycle basis. So in particular, I can pick the one that is the smallest one according to the perturbed edge lengths, right? So just mucking around a little bit with the edge lengths doesn't do anything to linear independence, and I don't really change anything in the relative ordering of cycle lengths. And the trick there is basically I get rid of all the of all redundancies and of all ambiguities in here. And with this trick, I can actually go and construct a minimum cycle basis in polynomial time by looking at the right set of candidates. In order to identify these candidate sets, what we have to do is we have to get properties of this set of relevant cycles. And what we want to do is we basically want to identify a suitable set of candidates that in general, if we do not perturb the edge length, can still be exponentially large, but by perturbing the edge lengths at the end, we will actually get a set of candidates that is guaranteed to contain at least one relevant cycle from which we then can get a minimum cycle basis. So that's basically the logic. As a side remark, another way of doing that is essentially just fixing one shortest pass between any two points. And one can show, again, this is a little bit tricky how to do that. One can show that you can just fix a particular system of shortest path between any two points. And this is equivalent essentially to this perturbation procedure. So if you just fix for any pair of points one of the shortest path between them, then this also this is also sufficient to get the candidate set back down to polynomial size. So that's basically just a preview of what we want to do next. The next thing basically is to ask what are properties of these relevant cycles. And I see we, because of the lecture that most of you want to attend, we basically should come to an end here in a couple of minutes. So just the most obvious property, if we have a cycle that is relevant, then obviously it has to be an elementary cycle, because if it's the disjoint union of two cycles, where that disjoint union obviously is longer than any one of the two themselves. The first observation is for getting a minimum cycle basis, indeed we only need to look at real cycles. More interesting properties about relevant cycles than next week, and we just stop here so that everybody can make it to the lecture at leisure.